We are absolutely thrilled to be working with TSI. We interviewed sensor manufacturers around the world. We're getting frustrated and a little bit nervous that we would never find a company that had the ability to make the quality sensor, to collaborate with us around what we're doing, and to absolutely have the most incredible customer manufacturer relationship that we could imagine. And we have quite a UVA, University of Virginia contingency in our founding board. And so we're also convinced that TSI was the right company when we found out that Bo Farmer, the CTO, hails from the University of Virginia. So all the way around, we're absolutely thrilled to be collaborating with TSI. So to get started, you will know by the end of this, my presentation, which will only last about 10 minutes, that buildings are in fact probably our best medicine and our best way to stay healthy. So the next slide, please. So we already kind of went all over this. I work a lot with ASHRAE around indoor air quality and best practices. And I'm now working with my colleagues in our Building for Health company. Next slide, please. So in the next couple minutes, I would like to talk about how key the indoor environment is to supporting human health, productivity, learning, all of the goals that we aspire to as people. I'd like to talk with you about some of the new tools that have shown us clearly just how intimate the relationship is between our health and the indoor environment. And then thirdly, how can we manage our buildings, the indoor environments, and specifically indoor air quality, to bring out the best in all of us. So the next slide. So my journey from medicine to wanting to investigate our surrounding environment really began when I was in medical school. So this is me back in my 20s. I wanted to have an adventure, so I went to Papua New Guinea for 4 months to practice medicine as a student. And I had a great time. It was all the adventure that I could have hoped for and more. And the next slide. When I was in Papua New Guinea, this is a hospital that I was based in primarily. And you can see the conditions look a little different from what we're used to in Boston, in the Harvard hospitals, in Minnesota, really in the United States. You can see the men's tuberculosis ward in the middle, concrete floors that were not particularly well swept. On the right, that's me in the operating room looking at a patient. I had flip-flops on my feet. The surgical nurse did not wear gloves. Despite the apparent lack of hygiene on surfaces, these patients did really well. They went home when we thought they would. They didn't get new infections while they were in the hospital. And I was really startled because when I went back to Boston, back to the Harvard hospitals, I realized that patients contacted organisms in the environment and got infections, even though it looks sterile. So I realized early on that there were components beyond what is visible and beyond what's on surfaces that were important to patient outcomes. Next slide, please. And in fact, here we are, fast forward to 2020, now 2021. We're dealing with this COVID-19 pandemic. And interestingly, we now know that the airborne route of transmission is really most impactful with the SARS-CoV-2 virus. But if you go back in time and look at these other prominent pandemics that have afflicted the human race, all of these pandemics are caused by respiratory viruses that adapt very easily to their environment. They're single-stranded RNA viruses. But more importantly, because pandemics are caused by viruses that are very agile, they mutate rapidly, we want to be really careful that we're not creating indoor environments where we spend 90% of our time. We do not want to create environments that could unintentionally promote the evolution of pathogenic viruses and bacteria. So for that reason, it's really time to make visible the indoor components that impact human health and microbial infectivity. Next slide, please. So let's just take a closer look at the human environment in buildings. So Let's start the video, please. So as I'm talking, little droplets come out of my mouth and nose that carry all the normal bacteria and viruses in my airways. Same as everyone else who's breathing. These little droplets are about 100 microns in diameter. You can see this engineer is working away. She's leaving her skin particles and all of the Staph aureus and Candida and viruses that normally reside on our skin. That's all good. She's not sick. That's a normal state of equilibrium between humans and microbes. Those particles coming out of her nose are normal. Her GI tract is illuminated because we have lots of organisms and particles in our GI tract. So you can see that there's a very active exchange between human beings, surfaces, and air. And again, that's all fine. That doesn't mean that the space is unsafe or unclean. It just means that human beings shed organisms into our environment, and then depending on how the environment is managed, the health or lack of health for both humans and microbes will be influenced. So again, don't move away from your roommate or family member right now, because these particles and organisms are all very normal. Next slide, please. So how do we actually begin to study ways to manage our indoor environment to support health? And to do this, to understand the connection between the indoor environment and health, we need to gather data from two fields. We need to gather data on humans, and we need to gather data simultaneously on their environment. And a great place to do this sort of study is actually a hospital. Not because we're just focusing on patients in hospitals, but because this is a setting where we can learn about the impact of indoor air on all of us at all times. So this is a study from about 2015. We did it in a brand new hospital in the Chicago area. It was LEED Silver, all single rooms with private baths and vestibules. So in this study, which went on for about 13 months, we measured all of the things you see listed in the middle: temperature, hand hygiene compliance, pressurization, lighting, CO2, humidity, room traffic, room air changes, and outdoor air. There was constant filtration throughout the whole space, so that was not a variable. So we took all of those environmental metrics and correlated them with patient outcomes, specifically infections, to see if there was a connection between the patient room environment and the patient outcome. And to my great surprise, next slide, the most powerful correlation, which none of us would have predicted at the time, was low relative humidity in the patient room was associated with more infections. So dry air is bad for the patients. And if you look at this graph, on the y-axis, you see the average number of infections of all sorts. You can see the lines over on the right: respiratory, GI, urinary tract, skin, and eye, both bacterial and viral. And on the x-axis, you see the indoor relative humidity. And this study identified a zone 40 to 60% indoor relative humidity, where we had an all-time low of particularly respiratory and GI infections. The green dotted line are urinary tract infections. They were related to mobility and hygiene, so that was outside of the purview of the environment. But we identified this 40 to 60% indoor relative humidity that was great for patients. This interval has been identified again and again for a number of reasons, which I don't have time to go into. But by looking at human health and the indoor environment together, the power of indoor humidity was revealed. Next slide, please. And in fact, indoor air, humidity, particle counts, VOCs, affects all of our systems. It affects our eyes, causes either healthy eyes or environmental dry eye syndrome. Our brain, our cognitive functioning, productivity, and learning is very much affected by indoor parameters. Respiratory infections and reactive airway disease, or asthma, is highly responsive to indoor parameters. And skin and even wound healing is affected by the indoor environment. So clearly, As human beings, we don't exist in silos. Our health is impacted by the environment around us, which is indoors. Next slide, please. But unfortunately, despite this powerful connection, and for reasons that, again, are a whole nother discussion that have to do with psychology and education and who knows what else, the two fields of building management and building science and human health and medicine have become very disconnected. Building as engineers, architects, or building managers, we focus on energy consumption, we focus on first costs, operating costs, real estate value. And then over in another silo, in medicine, where we're in the business of sickness more than prevention, we treat infections, we perform surgical procedures to boost our organs, whatever. Fix whatever the problem is, we prescribe prescriptions. But we need to bring these two areas of research together so that we really can clearly manage our environment, our indoor environment, to support health. Next slide. And so I started this work again a long time ago in sort of a consulting mode. And then thankfully, my colleagues and I came together and we formed Building for Health. And again, we needed an accurate and affordable sensor to monitor the components of indoor air that would feed into our proprietary health algorithm to reveal a health impact rating. We looked around the world and we finally met Bo Farmer at TSI, and he brought us into the rest of his team. And now we're working with TSI and using their AirAssure monitor. Next slide, please. So for our platform, again, this is a proprietary platform and algorithm that reveals the degree of health of your indoor space. So the TSI sensor measures the components that are essential for the algorithm, feeds them into our equation, and we reveal for you the health impact rating of your space or your opportunity for improvement, which is another way of seeing it. So we are very, very thankful to be working with TSI. Next slide, please. So you might think, well, this is going to be too expensive or too hard to do, or it's a pie in the sky dream to monitor our air and to manage it for health. But in fact, this is being done in lots of buildings, not with a TSI AirAssure monitor and not with a B4H algorithm. But if you happen to be primate in the NIH research lab, or an astronaut in outer space, or if you're a famous painting or expensive piano or a book, you're going to be in a space where the air is monitored for the health of those things. So it can be done. But first, we need to make visible the components of the air that are important for our health. So it kind of raises the question, what are humans worth when we're what is our monetary value? Next slide, please. So this is just a little aside story. This is my son, Colin, who's a physician as well. We were in Peru hiking a couple of years ago. We were sort of in the middle of nowhere. You can see from the trail on the right, which was a good trail. We were really in the boonies. As we were hiking along, next slide, we came upon this little stone building that was a mausoleum, and it had the bodies of the important village leaders who had passed away, obviously. So the people had died, they'd been embalmed, covered up with cheesecloth, and placed in this mausoleum. And when Colin and I went in, we saw that the air was being monitored and managed. So I was really curious about this. I thought, wow, here we are in Peru, and they have sensors and monitors for this space. And I thought to myself, next slide, please. Aren't we valuable before we die? Aren't we valuable enough that we can monitor and manage our indoor air for human beings when we're still alive and functioning? Next slide, please. And if you're thinking that, well, this is just a trend that is in the forefront of our minds because of COVID-19, in fact, this map from the CDC shows that for a variety of reasons, bacteria and viruses are always evolving and mutating. And there are other infectious pathogens, you know, down the road that we have to be aware of. So we need to monitor and manage our indoor environment, not just during COVID-19, and not just because of infectious diseases, but we also need to manage our indoor environment to support our health for all of the other functions, just to be alive, to learn, to be productive. It's absolutely a key need that we have as humans to see what's around us. Next slide. So I just want to say thank you. I want to say thank you to TSI and to for the development of this AirAssure sensor. It's in one package. We have all of the sensors that we need. I want to say thank you to my B4H team. And I'm really looking forward to continuing with a great relationship with TSI.